These two teams have played each other twice this year. Villanova led both times at the half, but then Patrick Ewing and the Hoyas pulled it out. 52-50 in overtime and 57-50 when the rematch was staged in Landover.
Patrick Ewing got that tap. That ought to be Villanova ball. Good call. Brent, when you look at those scores of Villanova in the NCAA tournament, they have played every game in the 50s. That is their game, so fans ought to keep up with that early. Georgetown starts in a 1-3-1 half-court trap, trying to force Villanova to go faster.
They get a turnover right away off the defense, and they break free with Jackson, but there was a whistle. Gary McLean committed the foul as they came across the timeline.
And if you're John Thompson, that's exactly what you want to do early in this ball game. Create a pace on defense that forces Villanova to push the ball towards the basket. Now defensively for Villanova, they play a zone defense. They match up to where the Georgetown players are, and they play this matchup zone as well as anybody in the country.
Patrick Ewing, Bill Martin, and now it is Jackson swinging it to David Wingate. Here's Martin. Reggie Williams is 34.
And you can see that Georgetown can take whatever you give them. They're very patient offensively. When it's time to run, they run. When it's time to be patient, they're patient.
Jackson misses, but Williams rebounds, comes back inside, and he pushed off. It's an offensive foul on Williams as he drove toward the glass. He pushed into his man.
That was excellent blockout technique that time by Eddie Pinckney, but what happened to him, he was blocking out so much, nobody picked up Williams.
Full court pressure right away by the Hoyas.
Villanova does a good job beating man-to-man pressure because McLean really protects the ball. Now there's the 1-3-1 defense on the part of Georgetown.
Unusual because Ewing comes out in this defense with Martin lurking in behind. Wayne McLean into the corner, and Wilbur, they trap, but Wilbur comes to Eddie Pinckney. Pinckney lost control but got it to Harold Presley, who put it in. It didn't look pretty, but it counts.
And why that was so effective is Eddie Pinckney took it right at Patrick Ewing to occupy the space. Ewing has such great leaping ability that unless you take the ball to him, he'll cover 2 men at one time.
Pinckney has been bothered the last few days by the flu. When I was over here at the Villanova practice earlier today, he worked early, then sat down for a while, but said he'd be fine tonight. Cross court to Jackson.
That zone is basically 2-3, but then they match up.
Wingate.
Off balance, still hit the shot. Great body control. For those that don't see a lot of basketball, that is legal to step out of bounds and throw it the first pass over.
Trying to get it into Presley. Kicked. And the ball remains in the possession of the Wildcats.
Georgetown can show zone defenses, man-to-man defenses, trapping defense. They do a little bit of everything.
Wayne McLean with 33, swings it back to Gary. Spelled differently. Wilbur getting it to Dwayne, who comes inside, and they're challenging the big fella early.
Now, here you see the tandem defense. Two players playing behind each other, and then they'll drop back in kind of a 2-3 alignment.
Wingate. He hits his first two. Again, McLean gets it up against that pressure, protecting the ball.
Georgetown now playing man-to-man defense. As I said, they really switch things around. Look for Villanova to try to get the ball to Eddie Pinckney. This defense helps Villanova because they can go ahead and take their time.
Pinckney ships it over to Gary McLean. Dwayne comes inside, and remember, he's a great streak shooter, and he made a brilliant move to get inside pressure that time.
Sensational shot because the defense on McLean was perfect.
Cross court, Williams.
Williams.
And again, what they've practiced to bring the ball inbound against that Hoya pressure. Pinckney far out, puts it down, and he traveled. And he'll go over to Georgetown on the turnover.
But Brent, you can see that Eddie Pinckney is used to playing against Patrick Ewing. They've gone against each other for 4 years. Eddie Pinckney's freshman year, one of the great games of all time against Ewing. He's not afraid to take it to Patrick.
Both teams sizzling in the early moments. Georgetown 3 of 4, Villanova perfect.
That defense is backed inside the foul line now, so they're gonna give the outside shot to Georgetown.
Ewing will take one outside. Missing, but Martin rebound.
Basket by 24, Bill Martin.
Presley, a good ball handler. You would expect to see him in the backcourt a lot for Villanova against Prussia.
Well, every member of the Villanova team, pretty good ball handler.
Pinckney ships it back. And the foul is called as he rose in the air to make the pass. Pinckney committed the foul.
Very difficult for Eddie Pinckney to put the ball on the floor that far away from the basket. Normally, those two dribbles would get him to the basket. He was 22 feet away, and when you put it on the floor, then the guards can come in and trap. Ewing available for the lob.
But he has to come out against that defense and now sends it to Wingate. They haven't gotten Ewing any easy baskets yet. Jackson from the perimeter.
People that try to compare this Georgetown team with last year's, the big difference is offensively, they're just so superior. Great shooting team. Nice clear out for Barry McLean.
Against the pressure, he gets it up, but he traveled. He made that spinning move against the trap, and Jackson says something right in Gary McLean's face.
And that, again, was a different look by Georgetown. They double-teamed with their guards that time and made it tough for McLean.
Timeout, Georgetown with a four-point lead. 14:54 left in the first half. 50-year-old Roland Vincent Massimino. In his 12th year at Villanova, played college basketball at Vermont, where he was a reserve guard. Later went on to become a high school coach, then moved to Stony Brook College on Long Island, was an assistant at Penn, was hired by Villanova, and has been a success there ever since. An ideal man for that program. Villanova is perfect shooting from the floor, but they have committed four turnovers against that Georgetown pressure already. Inside to Wingate. Oh, Ewing got up in the air, was off balance. He's all right. Harold Jensen has checked into the game for Villanova, number 32.
Credit Eddie Pinckney again. He did not get the rebound, but terrific block out on Patrick Ewing so that Patrick couldn't get position.
This is Harold Jensen.
Jensen, the big star in the North Carolina win. Dwight Wilbur has just not been able to get in the game in the NCAA playoffs.
So difficult to get your shot against Georgetown. McLean comes up and he's been banging away. He's carrying him offensively with those three field goals already.
You notice how well Villanova gets back on defense. It's very difficult to get fast breaks against them. Their transition from offense to defense is great.
Williams, double team. Presley goes for the loose ball off Williams out of bounds, and it goes over. Great play by Harold Presley.
I thought Jensen pulled Williams' arm on that play and got away with a foul. Williams doesn't look strong, but he's off a worry.
Villanova can tie at this trip.
Wayne McLean looks like he wants to take one again.
They will want to get Jensen into the game if they can. Dumps it off to Pinckney. Maneuvering on Ewing. Missed. Snapped down by Martin. Jackson comes inside. Great pass. Hey, hit David Wingate, who'd come down the baseline.
Well, you can't appreciate what a great catch that was by Wingate. Has a body flying right over his head and still pulls it in.
They're stationing Pinckney out away from the basket. Here's Jensen's first shot, and he's on the money. He's a key man for Nova tonight.
That's what you like, to have a fella come off the bench and play so positively. Jensen has really been on a three-game tear.
And Villanova is playing positively against Georgetown, something we have not seen throughout this tournament. Georgia Tech pushed them, but in the early going against St. John's, the Hoyas went on a tear in the first and the second halves. Williams with a pump fake, and quickly Pinckney comes over to help out. They get it back to Ewing.
Fine defense by Villanova again, not to let Reggie Williams have that baseline, even though he had the good pump fake and was open. Pushed by Pinckney.
Jump hook by Ewing's on the mark.
Oh, a dangerous crossover by McClain. He had the ball up awful high. Notice how the senior McClain pulls things back out and again sets up the tempo that Villanova wants. He never rushes the action.
Pinckney outside. Now remember that he's a natural forward. They've moved him to the center because he simply is the biggest man and the toughest inside. But when he came to this school as a freshman, Burley John Pannone was the center, and Pinckney operated out on the wing. So he can bring Ewing outside as he has been doing here tonight. Williams, great player, doesn't get enough credit.
We're looking at a guy that didn't make first or second team all
Almost
conference.
Stolen by Wingate. Villanova gets it back.
McClain wants it right back. Feisty player.
Jackson and McClain will be a marvelous duel. And of course, John Thompson can also send Horace Broadbacks out after him. Dwayne McClain puts it down. Lost it out of bounds. It goes over. That's the fifth turnover by Villanova.
And Brent, you can make physical mistakes for Raleigh Massimino, but not mental ones. And McClain made a mental one that time. No sense going inside knowing Ewing's there. Raleigh Massimino really upset with that last play.
Ewing sends it back to the corner to Williams, and he's two for two the last two trips.
Now the double team starting to give Villanova a lot of problems. Notice how they keep the double team on because they know they have Patrick Ewing in the back to protect.
Will this pressure wear down Villanova? They are not as deep as Georgetown. Pinckney rushes for the loose ball, puts it down, comes inside, gets it to Presley, and Ewing came back, but Presley hit it.
You notice Patrick Ewing came about 25 feet on that pass, almost got there in time, but good play by Eddie Pinckney. The score a little higher than Raleigh Massimino would like, but if you look up there, we're under 10 minutes now, 18-14.
And Reggie Williams is just dead-eye from that corner. He has hit his four shots in this game so far. Remember, he came off the bench in last year's championship against Houston and won the MVP by scoring 19 points. And there, Martin, another of the seniors, knocks the ball out of bounds. And here comes a freshman, Perry McDonald. We've got a timeout. But already, John Thompson is starting to go to his bench. And we'll see that Hoya depth when you come back. Saturday afternoon against St. John's, Michael Jackson handed out 11 assists. Already here tonight, he has four. This was the prettiest. Wingate cut in behind, worked down the baseline, and hit the field goal.
Well, what was so great about that is Wingate caught the ball in traffic, and then even going full speed was able to stop on a dime and not be walking. I mean, you've got to be a good assist man, you have to have fellas that can catch the ball in traffic, and that's what Georgetown does so well. Jackson, you know, you're talking about 15 assists in a game and a quarter. Here's the trap again.
As Billy pointed out, the points are starting to mount up, and Massimino prefers a lower scoring game than what he's in right now.
Matter of fact, I think Villanova would be smart to pull it out a while.
Dwayne McClain drew the foul from Martin.
Brent, when you look at the score, and we said this at the top of the show, you multiply Georgetown's total now times four, And you're talking about an 80-point type game. In an 80-point type game, Villanova cannot win. They have to slow this pace down a little bit. And the way it looks, they're going to have to do it on offense.
You know, this game is being seen around the world via satellite by our servicemen and women through the Armed Forces television service tonight. Also being heard on radio. And I understand I mentioned earlier, Big John Pannone is playing basketball over in Spain. He's watching tonight. His brother Steve, of course. He sits on the bench over there for Raleigh Massimino, and he certainly wanted to send along his best to his brother and hope he's enjoying it in the early hour in the morning over there.
Crane continues to hit. Villanova picks up full court. Georgetown blows right by him.
With that great quickness, and here's McDonald. Pinckney rebounds.
And here's where Villanova cannot afford to get in a run-shoot game. Pull it back out, try to slow this game down a little.
Jackson with Jensen there. Better than normal against this tough defense. Stolen by Wingate, but he can't run it down after he tapped the ball. Gary McLean sealed him off. And Wingate is so quick defensively, he always gets his hand in on the basketball.
Good point, Brennan. John Wooden always said it's hard to teach quickness. That's what he tried to recruit, was quickness. If he had to take one particular asset of a player, and you saw Wingate go almost 18 feet there to knock that ball out of the way.
Brodnax is number 32, who just checked in. Jackson sits down.
And obviously, Georgetown, a big, big advantage on that bench. Villanova will have to go primarily with these five players plus one sub. The zone changes again.
Jensen gets it to McLean.
Pull it back out.
Bounce to Pinckney, who will come up on Ewing. Ewing sprawling to the ground, trying to draw the offensive foul. And I'll tell you, they have been more successful inside against Ewing than any team I've seen in the tournament to date, and that includes Georgia Tech.
I think the reason for that, Eddie Pinckney may be the quickest big man in the country in terms of getting the ball in the lane and turning on a guy like Patrick. Normally, Patrick Ewing is the man that has the quickness advantage.
Traveling on the turnover, he double dribbled.
John Thompson coming back with a substitute. McDonald, an outstanding player, very gifted, but doesn't have the experience in a game like this one.
It is so important against Georgetown not to let them get that early big lead. Villanova can tie the game at 20 this trip.
Wayne's got to watch the trap. We're talking about a team with three seniors that have been in the wars a lot.
McLean with a spinning move is tied it at 20.
He turned around coming back up court and spit on the floor like, take that, fellas.
Look at this shooting percentage against Georgetown. They have come to the summit, and both of them are playing like champions. Blotnacks.
Brent, maybe Jimmy Boeheim knew something. Hey, he faced these teams so many times. The coach of Syracuse said, St. John's cannot beat Georgetown, but Villanova can. And that was before the Memphis State game. I still think the pace for Villanova is going to tell in the second half of this game.
Great pass to Pinckney from McLean. Simply missed the shot, but it was that snap pass.
Eddie Pinckney's laughing. He loved the pass and knew he should have had it.
Georgetown on defense has been scoreless for the last 2:35. Villanova's running off six in a row. Presley couldn't get up on it. He's a strong rebounder. And now the Hoyas will try to end their drive. And Pinckney reached in from behind. Shouldn't have done that on Brodnack. Should never have given the official the opportunity to call that foul out.
You're right, Brent. He was chasing a quicker man and a smaller man down the court. It was better to run and take his position defensively. Eddie goes for the steal, and that's the second one. And that's a cheap one. That could come back to haunt him.
Ewing so far against Massimino's defense is 1 of 3 from the field. They have not been able to get him that easy slam.
Villanova's stays in that matchup. 2-3 zone defense, which they play so well.
At least two men watching Ewing on that side. Williams trying to come up. He is short. Goes for the rebound. Takes it away from Pinckney, and then Jensen fouled Williams. And Massimino said, I was so close.
And there again, Reggie Williams showing he's one of the great offensive rebounders in college basketball. Again, look at that physique. He doesn't look like he'd be tough inside, but he's so wiry and so quick. He gets a lot of rebounds. Good pass out by Patrick Ewing. Rather than try to force it, gets it right back.
Now he turns around inside. Presley coming up, and Wingate was over his back on the rebound.
There's the play on the inside. Patrick had just fed the ball back outside. Then he turns with that patented jump shot of his. Doesn't make it. Presley with a good rebound. Wingate doesn't get there in time.
Mark Plansky has checked in for Villanova, and Ed Pinckney will take a break here at the 6:36 mark. Harold Presley putting it on the floor. They go to trap him in the corner. He tries to come free, and it goes over. He could not. Now, again, that trap defense.
Right, Brent. Now, Presley's job is merely to get the ball over half court, not to get down in the corners. Had he stopped as he got over the 10-second line, he'd have had an opportunity to give that ball out. You can't take it to the corners against a club like Georgetown.
Again outside, and they knocked away, and Jensen's got it. Presley's ahead. Boy, has come back quickly. Here's Presley. Ewing back for the rebound.
Again, there's Patrick Ewing, all 7 foot of him, running the full 90-foot distance and getting there for the rebound. And he's getting a little heat from John Thompson. He wants him down low to get in there to rebound.
Williams gets behind. Presley misses, but he's got that offensive rebound, and Plansky fouled him.
Is he quick off his feet, or is he quick off his feet? You'll see Reggie Williams go up here. There he goes up once. He comes down. He goes up. He comes right back again. Three times right off his feet before the other players can get off twice.
Mark Plansky, his first team spin.
Jensen and Plansky, of course, have both come off the Villanova bench. Ewing will sit down, and Thompson lectured him as he came off the floor about just what you said, staying out too far away from the basket, trying to dribble the ball, and gave up the ball on the turnover.
A point about John Thompson's theory on big men. He said he doesn't want a pivot man that can shoot jump shots. He wants a pivot man that can play around the hole, and that's exactly what he was telling Patrick. He's received that lecture since his freshman year.
Now the veteran Ralph Dalton moves in, and the Hoyas do not lose all that much with Dalton on the floor. Williams comes in and picks up his miss and puts in a field goal. There he is again, slicing like a hot knife through butter to get the rebound. Comes back with the steal.
That's a sensational turnaround. Villanova in a position to take a 2-point lead, finds himself two down. A 4-point turnaround on Williams' efforts.
Puts it on the floor, gets inside the defense. It goes over. Williams and Wingate got a little too close, and Raleigh's saying he traveled when he put it down. That's what he was protesting that time to the official.
Part of that is working the official. Now Villanova trying to force tempo too much. There's no hurry there.
Ewing is going to return.
Patrick wants to get in the game so bad he just knocked over half the scorer's table.
Took that possession arrow and banged it off the floor. They've recovered it. Martin will sit down for the Hoyas. How about the points off of those turnovers?
Yeah, that's part of Georgetown's story. They beat you in so many ways, and that's certainly one of them.
Here's Dalton. He'll stay on the floor, has it rejected, and it'll go over to Villanova.
That was some block by Presley. Now, Presley on Saturday had a 1-for-8 game, and we both thought he played a sensational basketball, and that's why.
On the Williams free throw, Coach Massimino moved Gary McLean in just to Williams' right, but he can't get over to seal him off. Williams comes through, and he's got the field goal.
That was just poor execution, Brent. You've got to move as soon as that ball is released out of there. You got to move over there and get in the way of the shooter. You got to block him out.
Billy, you pointed out the score. We've got another 5 minutes, and Georgetown has only scored 2 points since that 9:52 mark.
That's right. Now we're getting back into a situation where you look at the score and you say, hey, it swung back to the tempo that Villanova wants. At the 10-minute mark, Georgetown had 20 points. That's an 80-point game. Now it looks like we're getting back down to a 60-point game.
Dalton and Ewing together on the floor.
Now, you notice Presley that time did not go down in the corner. That was the wise thing to do. Straight man-to-man by Georgetown.
Ewing coming over on Pinckney, and Jackson has possession. Marvelous defense. Jackson trying to come through, though. Ewing was crashing to the floor for the loose ball.
Patrick Ewing, that's why he's such a super player. He runs 80 feet, dives for the loose ball. No prima donna there. I thought he committed a foul, but got away with it. But still, what an effort.
Takes the inbounds pass. Shakes Jensen, off Jensen.
Jensen gets away from those elbows.
Yeah. Wingate, to be short. Pinckney rebounding.
Wise move by Eddie Pinckney. There was a semi-fast break there, but Villanova doesn't want a fast break. Eddie just wants to walk down the court. Very smart. That's the key to this club. We're talking about a senior team here.
Ewing trying to keep Pinckney from coming through the baseline, and he was effective defensively inside.
They'd like to get the ball to Eddie Pinckney, but it's
they did it behind Ewing, and he was fouled. Williams coming back. That's his second personal.
Now, there's a lot to that defense. Great weak side defense here by Williams, recognizing that Patrick Ewing's out of place. The other thing that's the key here, Brent, is that the Georgetown teammates don't want anybody to dunk on Patrick Ewing. And you watch Williams come across here. He makes sure there was no dunk on that play.
You know, there is a sad note surrounding the Villanova team. Al Severance passing away back in Philadelphia this morning. Raleigh Massimino telling me that he was Villanova basketball. He coached his team for 25 years, and at the first Final Four in 1939, Coach Severance took Villanova into the semis and lost to Ohio State. That was played up Northwestern in Evanston, Illinois.
And Brent, during his days, they were the cradle of coaches there. You had Ramsey and McCluskey, Duty Moore, Harry Litwack. It's had great coaches during that period of time in Philadelphia.
Ewing got his position. They won't stop that. That's where Thompson wants him, down low.
And John smiled on that one. And here comes a full court zone trap. Great pass. And a turnover by Presley that's not called. Sensational pass by Eddie Pinckney.
Maybe he does play better, sir. Presley comes inside, gets the high arc, and got the roll.
Everything's falling. Not a good shot.
They're not scared, are they?
They certainly are. Now with Georgetown having the two bangers.
Oh, and Ewing comes with the lob, and he says, let's go.
Well, just go back a couple of minutes when John Thompson took Ewing out and gave him a pretty good tongue lashing, telling him, get down around the basket.
Gary McClain. But it goes back to up-tempo.
That's right. This is...
Now it's Ewing on the other end.
Patrick Ewing was the man that went out to block that jump shot, and then he ended up down under the basket. He is putting on some show. Here's the zone trap again.
And Pinckney was fouled by Dalton. Martin returns for the Hoyas. Dalton will sit down.
Brent, in the days when you had the superior teams, here we see Patrick Ewing timing this pass beautifully, going about a foot and a half over the basket and slamming it down through. Watch this pass by Jackson. That's going to be assist number 5 or 6 already. Sensational catch and shot. That was the 6th assist by Jackson. 17 in less than a game and a half.
Jensen comes baseline inside of Williams and creates a shot.
Hey, Villanova's a good team, but they are a great team so far tonight.
Chuck Everson is playing now. He's a 7-foot, 1-inch junior out of Brentwood, New Jersey. And again, Pinckney will get a rest here by Coach Massimino. Last 2 minutes of the first half. Jackson dishes to Martin, turns, and Everson had a hand on it. Gary McClain, and now Villanova can go ahead.
And they ought to hold on to the ball for a while right here. And they are. They're going to four corners. They're going to try to spread Georgetown out and hold the ball for the rest of the half. A great move by Raleigh Massimino, because he has Eddie Pinckney on the bench, and he does not want to do this. Now, Georgetown will counter with a 1-3-1 trap. They will not let him hold it.
John positioning his players defensively, keeping them back in that zone alignment that you see. And what you are watching again is a relic. Almost everyone agrees that they'll go to the 45-second shot clock next year in this tournament.
I think John Thompson's had a great year coaching his club, but right now I don't know why he would allow Villanova to hold the ball. This really plays into Raleigh Massimino's hands. He's got to go out and chase him. Now, he's asking for a warning by the referee, but as long as Villanova throws the ball past that white hash mark, they are not in violation.
You can see Dwayne McClain standing just inside the hash mark on your screen, and Jensen is just inside it. You can see them playing catch right there, so no warning will be given.
And I think Georgetown should come out for another reason. They're not in the 1-1 yet. They could come out and aggressively attack Villanova, and even if they foul, Villanova doesn't get any foul shots. Raleigh Massimino has to be so happy now that he's getting by with this strategy. Kind of amazing.
With Georgetown leading by 1 point, and the clock running down here in the first half of this NCAA championship game in Lexington, Kentucky. I'm Brent Musburger with Billy Packer, and we certainly hope you're enjoying this one.
Georgetown goes man to man, and again, I can't understand why they allow Villanova to hold this ball.
Now they get it inside to Presley. He comes inside on Ewing. It wouldn't stay, but he comes back with the rebound. They went right at the big fella. Wingate comes free for the jump shot, but time has expired. And Villanova, for the third time this year, has taken the lead. And we had a little bit of a scrape underneath the basket at the end of the first half. Massimino is furious.
And we're going to have no call on a foul. But Brent, that has to be a big plus for Raleigh Massimino.
Look at Massimino lead his troops back to the locker room. And Thompson say, what's going on here?
All right, there's the shot by Wicket. Actually, the half ended right here. Everson goes. Williams goes after him. A good no call by the referee. Should have to call that a double foul or a no call, and it was a no call. I think a critical mistake by John Thompson at the end of the half. You've got Pinckney on the bench. You've got to go after him.
All right, let's go upstairs to Dick Stockton. Dick. I just spoke with referee Don Rutledge, and he said they did not call a personal because they thought that it was not intentional and not flagrant. Raleigh Massimino disagreeing with that. Rutledge is one of the referees, along with John Clockerty and Bob Diebler. They are working this national championship game. And what a surprise. Georgetown trailing, but remember, in their two previous meetings, Villanova led each time at the half, and the Hoyas came back to win it. Ewing. Georgetown regains the lead that quickly.
That was a great shot by Patrick Ewing, because Eddie Pinckney thought he had it timed perfectly. Dangerous pass. You notice this is what makes it so tough on Georgetown to force Villanova. Villanova just gets the ball over half court. They don't worry about attacking against it. Very patient. Some teams try to take it down into Patrick Ewing, and that's when they get in trouble and turn it into a pace game.
Gary McClain with Michael Jackson on him. Presley, double team, ships it out to McClain.
McClain got pushed.
Pinckney to Harold Jensen from the perimeter, rattles in. Jensen is now 3 of 3 off the Villanova bench. That's why he's starting the second half. Martin. Wingate. Pinckney has it. Delivered to him on the errant pass, and this will be Dwayne McClain. And Georgetown retreats. They're going to let Villanova bring it up.
Well, they have a hard time setting up that press. There you see that field goal percentage. Georgetown, not only during the NCAA tournament, but throughout the course of the year, held their opponents under 39% free throw shooting. No place for McLean to go, so he pulls it out. A time of possession for Villanova. They started getting what they wanted at the end of the second half.
You pointing out that Thompson may have made a tactical error by letting Villanova pull it out.
Oh!
Hits the field goal and drew the foul.
Eddie Pinckney this year has had 288 field goals, 256 fouls. Now watch this move. And you're talking about getting that shot off, being guarded by the best man in college basketball defensively. Patrick didn't like the call. Only his first personal foul. But you know, you get the feeling everything Villanova throws up there seems to go in. Great touch.
The first half of this game was as good a half of college basketball as I've ever seen. We'll see what unfolds here in the second half.
Eddie's a 72% free throw shooter, so solid on there. And John Thompson wants a timeout already. Very unusual timeout.
Frequently in this NCAA tournament, John Thompson and the Hoyas have blown teams out early in the second half. It is always a critical part of the game against this team. Triple team. Hoyas keep it.
There was Patrick Ewing caught in the lane with three men around him. There had to be somebody open.
Martin, short. Pinckney skies for the rebound.
That's a lucky break for Villanova. They weren't set in their defense, and Georgetown almost caught him napping. Eddie Pinckney starting to set outside now, drawing Patrick Ewing way out. That opens up a good drive for Dwayne McLean.
Jensen to the top.
Can't pick up your dribble like that if you're Jensen. And there, Eddie Pinckney waves to McLean, says, get the ball back outside again, and we're getting back to Villanova's pace of this game. This is not a delay game Villanova's playing. They're looking for an opening, just that Georgetown's playing solid defense here. Most teams would crack under this pressure.
Pinckney comes outside, ships it to Gary McLean.
Jump shot there. At Villanova zones now starting to pack inside 10 feet.
Williams was fouled after he took that pass, and that is the first foul on Dwayne McLean. And at the reminder that at the conclusion of our championship game tonight, Billy and I will select a Chevrolet Most Valuable Player for each team. Chevrolet, of course, donates a $1,000 scholarship to the general scholarship fund of both schools.
Brent, the jump shot's there for Jackson. He's just not looking to take it.
Ewing, short,
blocking,
hanging with him. And that on Ewing is the second foul.
If we see that one, Brent, Eddie Pinckney, instead of trying to challenge Patrick Ewing on the shot, watch him. He'll use his body on Ewing so Ewing can't get position. Great defensive play by Eddie Pinckney. Now Georgetown starting to pick up three-quarter court.
Offensive foul on Jensen. Williams threw the charge that time.
Pretty good Hollywood act by Williams. You'll notice here, Jensen makes his move. As soon as Williams felt the contact, he went down. Now, you couldn't knock a man down standing up like that if you ran over him with a truck. Good Hollywood job.
Jensen just telling the referee he fell down. I didn't didn't touch him that hard. Rodnack's off of Coach Thompson's bench.
And this is a good move by John Thompson because he's put his perimeter team out there.
And right away, Martin hits from that perimeter. And here comes the pressure again. Presley to help out. Martin hounding him.
Nice job by Presley.
Presley's a good ball handler.
And here again is where Presley becomes valuable because he gives them somebody other than a guard to bring the ball up.
Foul on Wingate. That's his second.
Foul is charged. Number 40.
The only guy that seems to be fired up and not quite calm is Raleigh Massimino. The other players on the Villanova team, anyway, seem to be very calm at this juncture in the game.
He gets fired up enough for everybody.
Dangerous pass. And here we come with a half-court zone trap now by Georgetown. Those lob passes will be dangerous.
Dwayne McClain ships it over to Presley, who came through.
Patrick Ewing. Now, Presley made that super scoop shot in Saturday's game. Patrick picks up his third. We'll probably see Ralph Dalton. It's a great catch by McClain right here. Presley goes in. Patrick Ewing got him with the body.
Here's Dalton into the game. He'll replace Ewing, who sits down at the 15:09 mark. And Ewing picks up those three fouls in 51 seconds of play. He went to the locker room at halftime without a single foul.
And here comes our experience on the foul line. Presley, he either hits them clean or throws up the bricks. On the year, only shooting 64% from the foul line.
Now what Massimino and Villanova have to be careful of is a letdown with Ewing over here on the bench. We saw Georgetown pick it up with Dalton on the floor against Georgia Tech, for example.
John Thompson has his shooting guards in the game. No room for Wingate.
Here's Dalton right away. And Dwayne McClain come from behind, fouled him. That's his second.
Ralph Dalton is a senior, but he has another year of eligibility if he decides to stay at Georgetown. A fine student, and he can move on if he wants to. It'll be interesting to see what his decision is.
Massimino and Villanova are on a 13-4 run. And that has built the six-point Wildcat lead. 14:57 to go here in the second half of this NCAA championship game between the defending champion Hoyas of Georgetown and the upstart Wildcats of Villanova, who entered this tournament seeded 8th in the Southeast region. They have upset Michigan, North Carolina. They eliminated Memphis State. And now they're trying to beat the defending titles.
Again, Dalton comes in to give excellent performance, hitting those two foul shots. Be hard for McClain. He's going to receive a double team here. Nice job with the crossover dribble. McClain is so smart. You know, he's been in these Big East wars for 4 years. Dalton can't handle Pinckney outside. Pinckney will go by him.
Jensen traveled.
Raleigh Massimino upset with Jensen, saying, on what basis are you going to dribble the ball in that lane anyway? And he's going to talk to Jensen on the sideline.
Ewing returning with those three personals.
Open on the side.
There is Wingate.
He took his spot and was patient enough to stay down in that corner of the zone. He would eventually get the jump shot.
Yeah.
tempo picks up when Georgetown goes into those double teams on defense. It's hard to go ahead and pull the ball back out.
Ewing jumps out. He covers more floor space than any center of recent memory. Somewhat like Bill Russell jumping out on everybody. Coming inside.
Basket.
Jackson fouled. Dwayne McLean put it down and came in for the hoop.
This basket's got to count. Yes, sir. There goes McLean. He's in the air. Excellent call by the official. You've got to establish defensive position early, and it didn't take place. That was some shot. McLean could do no wrong in this final four.
That time, they took advantage of Ewing being outside in that zone, and McLean put it down and went to the hole.
Exactly right, Brent. When Pinckney goes out, Patrick Ewing has to go out there with him because he's so quick and can handle the ball, and that opens up the baseline.
That's one of the new plays they worked hard on this morning in practice.
And McLean keeps up his incredible performance during the Final Four. Hadn't missed a free throw yet.
Jackson.
Long.
Martin crashed into by Presley. And that is Presley's first.
There's a case of Presley just happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. Billy Martin crashing the boards here as Jackson threw up a brick. Came bounding off of there. Billy Martin comes over. Presley just happened to get there a little too late. Just the fourth team foul on Villanova, so not too bad a shake. And they stay in the same matchup zone.
Ewing with the jump hook.
Now what's happening is the ball is being knocked away from the basket by Georgetown. That allows them to set up their defense. Referee has to warn him there to leave that ball alone.
Villanova has kept up its incredible shooting. 4 of 4 here in the second half. They are 77%, and Jackson has just picked up his second. And that is the sixth team foul against Georgetown, 4 against Villanova. We're at the 12:58 mark here in the second half.
And Villanova, an excellent free throw shooting team. On the year, they made within 10 free throws of what their opponents shot all year. So they go to the foul line a lot. Gary McLean really understands where those trap defenses are coming, and he's very patient with the ball.
Jensen wanted it inside, and Brodnack simply took it away from him.
That's a bad judgment by Jensen.
Wingate and charging on Brodnack, and oh, Gary McLean took a blow in the head area. Gary McLean is down.
There's no way he's going to be down long. You won't keep him out of this game. He'll be up. And there was a case where Brodnack just took it one dribble too far. He's up. He's not going anywhere. You couldn't take him out of the game. Here you see Brodnack. One dribble too many, then goes in the air. Good job by McLean, and you'll see him snap that head down there. He's all right. Now, that manager should stay out of the way because Raleigh Massimino doesn't want to have to take a timeout.
Meanwhile, the Hoyas have circled around John Thompson.
Now, see, Raleigh Massimino said, I don't want the timeout, and I'm not taking him out. You fellas stopped the game. My man was ready to play, and now Raleigh's going to lose his case, and they're going to charge him with a timeout, I think. Now, Raleigh doesn't want to use the timeout, so he'll quickly, great move on his part. He'll quickly get a replacement in for McLean so that he doesn't have to use the timeout. He wants to save him to the end of the game. He's not missing a trick.
And, of course, that was not a player control foul. So Plansky has to come in here and shoot the free throws. It's a 1-1, and Plansky's coming off the bench right away to the free throw line. The reason he selected Plansky, of course, is that's his best shooter. If he wanted a ball handler, he would have gone to Wilbur.
Well, Wilbur's a 75% free throw shooter. Plansky just 57, but Plansky is a pure shooter from the outside. I think I might have gone with experience there. We'll see how it works out.
Ewing and Martin. Martin gave it to Jackson. Quickly, Wingate lost it. Jackson runs it down. Pinckney blocks the ball out of bounds. He seals up that baseline very well.
What Georgetown is not recognizing is that that baseline is not going to be open because, as you pointed out, Pinckney's just filling the lane. The jump shots are available for Jackson and Broadnax. They're just not putting them up right now.
You saw McLean, of course, re-enter the game, and Plansky is out. Stolen by Villanova. Jensen couldn't hold on. Williams returns for the Hoyas.
I don't think that ankle has been nearly 100% ever since he sprained it in the Loyola game.
Brent, we look back up at the score. We're almost halfway through the second half, and you can see the points on that board favor a Villanova-type game again. They can keep it in the 60s at the rate we're going, maybe the 50s.
Martin on the turnaround. Villanova leading by a point.
Nice move with that left hand by McLean. For young players, they ought to notice how he can handle the ball both with his right and left hand. So no matter what they throw at him defensively, he can handle it. Really a fine point guard. Jensen's the one player that doesn't have the experience and sometimes gets into trouble by picking up his dribble.
Pinckney far outside in the corner. So he brings Ewing out with him. They get inside to Dwayne McLean. Ewing rejected it.
Ewing on the
Ewing ground. Ewing on the lob. Missed, lost control. Presley rebound.
And again, good judgment by Presley. Not to force the fast break. Slow the game down.
The Hoyas were looking for the big play to put them ahead at that moment.
Clear out for Presley. Again, good judgment.
McLean wanted to get the ball to Pinckney. Hit by the Hoyas. Reggie Williams over there, so Villanova keeps possession.
You wonder if fatigue is going to be a problem, Brent. This game has been very fast-paced from a standpoint of emotional energy, even though there's not a lot of scoring.
There is no doubt that Williams' ankle is bothering him. They've just taken him out again now, and Broadnax has gone into the game for Coach Thompson.
Presley had McLean, he just couldn't get him the ball.
Wingate knocks the ball out of bounds. Villanova retains possession. Here is Williams going back over to the bench. The ankle was sprained against Loyola, and he has been limping somewhat ever since. Now the open man is Dwayne McLean comes up. Offensive
big foul there.
Big swing. That would have been number four on Ewing.
This is a great pass across the lane. McLean goes up. They call a foul on McLean. That's called the rule of verticality. The defensive man has the right to the ground above his head, or the airspace above his head, I should say. Good call by the official.
Georgetown can take the lead this trip.
Shot. I think he was trying to make that one clean. Jensen's got to learn to keep his dribble alive. Raleigh Massimino now wants to use one of those timeouts.
In Lexington, Kentucky, we're at the NCAA National Championship game. I'm Brent Musburger along with Billy Packer. 9:34 to go, each coach with three timeouts remaining.
Brent Raleigh-Massimino could have waited for a TV timeout there, but he didn't because he knew that he can't afford to let Georgetown get a run. This game is getting down to the point now where you start thinking about those last 5 minutes. And if the scoring, see the foul trouble on Patrick, if the scoring stayed as it did now with 9:34 to go, we'd be talking about a 56-53 type game. Right down Villanova's alley. They've done a great job controlling the ball.
It back to Gary McLean. The shot's there on its way. Villanova regains the lead.
And McLean pounds that fist and looks over at his coach. Hard to take it away from seniors. They notice the last time they'll play in a collegiate game, and they're putting it all together.
Wingate. Martin came up. And he was fouled underneath by Pinkney. That's his third personal.
One of the few times tonight that Villanova has not gotten good block out position on the weak side. And Billy Martin is an excellent weak side rebounder. Now, Raleigh Massimino can think back of taking Eddie Pinkney out of that last 2 minutes of the first half. That's why he had him out of there. He didn't want his third foul at that time.
Time.
Billy Martin, a 64% free throw shooter. Came to Georgetown with Anthony Jones as two of the most highly recruited forwards in the country, both out of D.C. Full court pressure. And McLean tells Jensen to get out of the way. He feels he can bring it up on Jackson one-on-one, and he needs a clear out there by his teammate.
Jensen.
Oh, he is just filling it up. That's one of those Raleigh Massimino probably said, no, 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 yes, yes, yes. Not letting Patrick Ewing touch the ball in low, so that means jump shots are available.
Wingate. Pinkney.
Patrick Ewing didn't anticipate that pass coming inside. One of the few times you'll see him out of position defensively. Jump shot.
Jackson. Villanova. Pinkney comes up with it.
Brent, one of the few times I've seen Patrick Ewing look like he's a little tired. He may have to come out here for the rest.
Broadnax fouling McLean. Thompson.
Foul is charged to number 32, Horace Broadnax. His second personal foul.
You don't see many double and triple rebounds go up on the board if Patrick Ewing doesn't have a piece of at least one. And on that last occasion, he didn't get any of them. He's bending over now, and the sign of a big man that bends over, grabs his pants, is one that he's a little tired.
Williams returns, and Broadnax.
You notice Patrick Ewing down on the lane, Brent.
Thank you.
give it back to him.
Pinkney with a move inside. That foul on Wingate and not Ewing.
There's Eddie Pinkney, made our Pan Am team, all Big East, all conference player. Sensational fake on the inside, and even though Ewing gets help, he can't get there in time. That was a great maneuver inside. Foul's going to be called on Wingate. Shooting two. That's surprising, and again, I'd like to point out, I think Patrick's a little tired. That's twice in a row, Grant, that Eddie Pinkney was able to get good position, and that doesn't happen to Ewing often. Take this game very seriously. He said they get serious when the mallet goes down. Well, this mallet has been down since the tap. Oh, that's a walk by Jackson. Got by with it.
Wingate. Presley rebound.
Brent, do you sense that Georgetown's starting to tighten up a little bit on that jump shot? They stay with the man-to-man, and that field goal shooting percentage is unbelievable by Villanova.
Pinkney gets inside.
He walked and got away with it anyway. John Thompson's got to go timeout here, and he's going to call one. He's got to.
Seconds remaining, and Villanova leading the defending national champion. How about the time of possession?
Well, this has been the key of the game. You can remember in the first half when the game was swinging Georgetown's way, actually they had the ball in their possession more than Villanova. But in this half, you can see Villanova doubling the time of possession. They're controlling the ball. It's their pace of the game. And for Georgetown now, they have to start looking at that clock a little bit, realizing they're behind, and that's when that jump shot is hard to get out of your hand. That rest ought to help Patrick Ewing. He'll be much more active on the boards. Raleigh Massimino using every second of that timeout. His players have been out there. Let's see, Brent. Jensen is a sub, but Pinkney has not been out of the game. Dwayne McClain has not been out of the game, and Presley has not been out of the game. And Gary McClain was only out for a second or two, so he's got four fellas that have gone all the distance.
And again, Williams sitting down, and I suspect it is that ankle that has been bothering him considerably here tonight. Broadnax on the floor for the Hoyas as possession moves it to Jackson.
They're wanting to go inside, but the jump shot's what they got to take. There it is. Sensational. That shows you some guts when a man will take that shot when it's available, even under this tight situation. They're waiting for Gary McClain to come back and take this ball away.
They get it to Jensen. They go to the trap in the corner. He's got to come free. And they've lost it. It goes to the Hoyas, and now they can pull to within one.
Brent, the big problem there was Gary McClain didn't come back for the ball, and you notice when he doesn't handle it, Villanova really has problems in that trap.
Rodnax coming inside Gary McClain. He was fouled by McClain, and that's number two.
And gonna call it a two-shot foul. Raleigh Massimino did not like it, but that was a good call. Referees have worked an outstanding game today. I want to point out, too, Brent, for fans that don't realize this, but 96 referees started this tournament, and they worked their way game by game based on merit to get here. So a great accomplishment for them.
It's a one-point Villanova lead, 5:09 to play in regulation. These two teams have been overtime once this year.
5 seconds. You must get the ball inbounds in 5 seconds, and that's not when it leaves your hand as the passer. That's when it touches another player inbounds. Jensen upset, and the senior leadership calming him down a little bit.
Georgetown trying to take the lead.
Billy Martin getting in Ewing's way.
Wingate. And the Hoyas lead.
They better get the ball to Gary McLean again. Defense back in a little tighter now. Trying to go to Pinckney in there on Ewing. Straight man to man by Georgetown.
They get it inside to Pinckney. Comes up on Ewing. Lost control.
Raleigh got exactly what he wanted. He better calm down. He cannot afford a technical foul here. You cannot give up a technical foul here. He's looking for a little help on the sidelines. He better be careful. And Georgetown's going into the delay game. Four corners by Georgetown. A lot of time to play in this game. And I think if I were Raleigh Massimino, I'd pull back and take a little rest. Don't go out and chase him this early, and that's what he's going to do.
They lose it. Bounced off Brodnack's foot, right to Dwayne McLean, and now Villanova trying to regain the lead.
Raleigh wants a timeout. He wants to set strategy. Excellent move by Raleigh Massimino.
And 25 seconds remaining in regulation of this NCAA championship game. Georgetown leading by a point right now. That's the timeouts remaining. Thompson and Massimino each with two. As for that possession arrow in case of a jump ball right now, well, it is pointing in the direction of Villanova, even though that official is blocking it. As for the foul trouble, McLean and Pinckney with three for Villanova, Ewing and Wingate with three. There's a clean shot. Pointing right. Raleigh Massimino, who has done another splendid job of bench coaching here tonight in this championship game, coming in as a heavy underdog.
And for those millions of fans that are watching their one basketball game of the year, that possession arrow means if there's a jump ball situation, the ball goes over to the team that it's pointing towards their goal, and that would be Villanova. Georgetown goes back in his zone. I think this favors Villanova again because they'd like some more time to go off that clock without pressure. I think Raleigh Massimino likes it too. He'll take another minute and a half off the clock looking for a good shot.
Having to help out inside. Jensen puts Villanova ahead at the 2:35 mark.
Ice water in his veins. They gave him the shot and he took it. I think back of that North Carolina game when Jensen came in and really turned the ball game around. Being behind, Villanova can't go four corners. Georgetown can't go four corners.
Wingate has lost it. And Pinckney is fouled. And that is four on Wingate.
Brett David Wingate's been getting by going to baseline. What he really wants to do when he drives in there is pass that ball off to Patrick Ewing. But the Villanova defense is all shifting down in there, putting four men in the lane, and there's no place to go.
For Villanova, number 54, Ed Pinckney, shooting 1-1.
There's Pinckney with the 1-1.
Eddie's been standing on that foul line a long time. He ought to move off of that to get himself a little more relaxed.
For Reggie Williams, replacing number 32, Forrest.
72%.
Williams will try it again on that tender ankle. And Broadnex will sit down.
Don't start stepping in too soon. Let's play a game, 1-1.
By Eddie Pinckney. Now Raleigh Massimino wants that defense to pack inside that blue painted area. Don't give up any layups. Make them beat you from the outside. Five men in the blue paint.
Wingate. Jensen.
Raleigh Massimino's going to spread it out now and try to hold the ball for the remaining minute and 42 seconds. Georgetown's going to have to chase and trap. Four corners now.
Jensen is fouled by Jackson. We'll shoot 1-1. This would be one of the greatest upsets in the history of championship games at the NCAA tournament. Broadnax and a quick timeout after the field goal. While Jensen was shooting, Reggie Williams again had to leave the game because of that injured ankle. Villanova ahead by three with a minute 15 left in regulation. And whom do you foul down the stretch of this game?
Well, we've said that Villanova is an excellent free throw shooting team. And you'll notice that Presley at 64%, and the man that's been very uncertain from the foul line, a guy that sometimes swishes but sometimes throws air balls.
As for Georgetown.
Well, in the case of Georgetown, if they have an Achilles heel, it is free throw shooting. There you see Jackson the best on there. So they've got a lot of fellas you can attack. Percentage wise,
this the last college game for Patrick Ewing at Georgetown, the end of an era. Three times in 4 years he has brought him to the title game, and for Ed Pinckney, his last game. They've dueled each other for 4 years.
Nobody guarding the man taking the ball out of bounds. Now what happened? Broadnex tried to pull Presley down, which he did. Jensen gets fouled. Now Presley's hurt. What happened is Broadnax pulled him to the ground trying to draw a charge. Presley went down very hard. It's a trick a lot of people try to use. They don't guard the man taking the ball out of bounds and try to draw the charge. We'll see it right here. Now watch it. You'll see Broadnax pull him to the ground. It should have been a foul on Broadnax. Really a dirty play. Just a plain dirty play. I mean, that's one thing to play hard. That's a dirty play.
He took a knee in the groin area, and that's why he was shaken up. He comes back now down to the free throw line.
Jensen, who has come off the bench. He's 5 of 5 from the field in this game, and he's perfect from the free throw line. He's 3 of 3.
Hey, nothing but net.
Now 1:10 remaining.
A little uncertainty by Georgetown.
Ewing. McClain rebounding inside of a minute, drew the foul, and Villanova with a chance to stage one of the greatest upsets in the history of the NCAA championship finals.
They're starting to celebrate a little bit, and if I was the Villanova players, considering their competition, they better get down there and stay all serious. Eddie Pinckney doing a little slap and five. There's a lot to play yet.
Have turned it over, and right away Georgetown commits the foul.
It's going to be Jensen back on that foul line. Brandon, you talk about a bench player. They are ecstatic. That's Raleigh's son right there, shaking hands with everybody. He can't believe it either. How tough it is to repeat, huh?
Harold Jensen coming to the free throw line is a sophomore out of Trumbull, Connecticut. He was somewhat of a disappointment as a freshman for Coach Massimino. Even earlier this year, he wasn't certain how much play he'd get out of it. But here in the NCAA tournament, he has suddenly become a shooting hero. That's his first miss, and it was a big one. 61-56, but the Hoyas will have to hurry. Reggie Williams is back. Ewing rams it in.
Georgetown wants another timeout, and they get it. Big misses on that free throw line. That's 2 straight 1-and-1s.
That was Georgetown's last timeout. Raleigh Massimino has 2 left against John Thompson.
John trying to say who called the timeout. The man that called the timeout was Grodnax. He doesn't want the timeout, but it was called legitimately. Brent, those free throws have kept Villanova on the mark all game. They started celebrating with a 5-point lead, and on the line, they've now missed the front end of 2 straight 1-and-1s. Those are nails on the coffin if you can put them in there.
So that timeout call by Brodnax is costly. Possession arrow still pointing towards Villanova if there's a jump ball. The man who has to be absolutely overjoyed is there behind Fanone, the longtime trainer, Jack Nevin. Been confined to a wheelchair, suffering from Lou Gehrig's disease.
There's a movement underway to name their new field house at Villanova after Jake.
And at the other end on the Georgetown bench, that's Mary Finlan, the academic advisor, the first person John Thompson ever hired. One of the great things about this game that I want to mention with 41 seconds to go, we have 2 schools with high-class programs right here. John Thompson has graduated 44 of 46 men who've reached the senior class. Raleigh Massimino, he is 38 of 38. These 2 schools did not cheat to get here tonight. They did it through hard work. I'm Brent Musburger along with Billy Packer. We're in the Rupp Arena in Lexington, Kentucky. There's 41 seconds to go. Georgetown trying to win its 2nd straight national championship. Villanova trying to deny them. Ewing's 4th personal foul.
Brent, again, only 2 seconds went off the clock. So 39 seconds with the fouling that you can do can really forestall this game the rest of the way. Now, that's been one of the big things talked about here at the national convention. what type of penalty to put into the game of basketball to prevent this from taking place. A lot of people are advocating that the team that's fouled ought to have the right to take the ball out of bounds so that the foul no longer can be done to stop the game. As we said at the top of the show, the clock will come in next year. I think that's a rule that needs to come in. Hits it. Georgetown really needs three possessions to get back in the lead or tie. Right now, 62-58, two possessions, you get 2 points. Each time down, you tie. He makes this one, then they need that third possession. Not a lot of time for three possessions.
And if he makes it, they can start the theme from Rocky in Philadelphia. Williams, Wingate.
Jensen almost got the ball, but even better yet, he went and knocked it out of bounds so Georgetown couldn't keep it going. Got to waste some time now just to go ahead and get her in.
Jensen. Wingate comes back, regains possession for the Hoyas. He drives inside for the layup.
No timeouts left. They called Williams for holding McLean. That was a big foul there because 5 seconds were just about ready to be called. Now, as everybody realizes, Georgetown has no timeouts left. So if they score, that villain, they have no ability to stop this clock except by fouling.
McLean is 5 of 6 from the free throw line in this game. He was 5 of 7 from the field.
Well, you like to have seniors on the foul line at the end of the game. I think back of that NC State team, Brent. Three seniors with a lot of experience carried them in that big upset over Houston.
Jackson.
Now, Brent, Villanova, if they're smart, they cannot lose this game. For the simple reason that they can hold the ball out of bounds after the next two scores by Georgetown if they get down there, and there's no way Georgetown can stop the clock. They just have to get it in bounds. There's a hold. Yep, two shots.
Rodnax with the intentional foul, and it is picked up that time. It was not earlier. Now Raleigh Massimino will use one of his remaining two timeouts to talk about how to handle the clock, how to handle the free throw situation here in the Rupp Arena.
And the man that they fouled intentionally, and it's about the only thing Georgetown can do, because as I pointed out, with 10 seconds on the clock, Villanova could just let the ball hang out of bounds the next two times they touch it, this game would be over. Now he takes that timeout. Presley will be on the foul line. situation is Raleigh Massimino. You want your fellas to calm down and understand exactly the situation. Number one, do not commit any fouls. Allow Georgetown, if they have to go all the way to the basket, but do not foul them, giving up a three-point play or stop the clock. If you're Presley, again, he's been feast or famine on the foul line. Georgetown fouled the right man. Kind of surprised with Raleigh Massimino that he doesn't go ahead and put a man bringing the ball up the court to make it a little more difficult to get the ball in bounds.
Jackson, and there are just 5 seconds
game's
left.
Over.
There will be no dynasty. Villanova has done it.
Now what happened? Georgetown did the only thing they could do. They knocked the ball out, and the referee had to stop the clock. That was a nice little trick by Georgetown. Brent, they could go ahead and try that. The referee had warned them once. They knocked it out, so the referee has to go do it. Go chase the ball down, and when he did, he stopped the clock.
And Villanova has moved to the brink of capturing this championship by blazing away at 79% from the floor. That, an NCAA tournament record.
What's incredible about that, Brent, they did it against a team that was holding opponents for the year and the NCAA tournament under 40%. Now, the key thing here for Villanova, one, they must get the ball inbounds within 5 seconds. That means it must touch a player from either team within 5 seconds. I think they've got to throw the ball up at least towards the half court area. They cannot afford to throw that ball in under their own basket, because with 2 seconds to go, Georgetown can get a piece of it and put it back up. Let's see if Raleigh Massimino tries to get the ball up court. And in a jump ball situation, the ball would go to Villanova.